And may I invite Dr. Salil Gupta, who's head of neurology in the Army Hospital. I forget his rank every time because every time I meet him, he's two ranks up. So, you know, I don't want to say his rank because... So we just call him and he's our dear friend. So, Salil, can you take your lecture ahead?
Salil is an air commodore. He's right now placed at Bangalore.
Oh, he's, yeah. That I know. What is it now? Air commodore.
Yeah, that's right, sir.
Air commodore.
Yeah, because every time I meet you, you're two ranks up, Salil.
Kind of you, sir. And it's indeed a privilege to speak in a session chaired by two stalwarts like Dr. Chapuria and General Kumar Velu. Thank you, sir, for both the kind words. I'd also like to thank my teachers, Professor Padma and Professor Rohit, for this very kind invite to speak here. And I would be speaking on strokes associated with meningitis. So I start with a typical case presentation of a case which we had seen a few years ago. In fact, this case was in Pune actually. And this lady would be a typical type of case which most of you would have seen in your practice earlier. So this is a 28-year-old female with advanced HIV infection on ART, as she's presented with fever of 2 months, cough of 1.5 months duration, and headache and altered sensorium of 15 days with signs of meningeal irritation. She also gave history of two very recent episodes of sudden onset focal neurological deficits of left side with findings which were there actually bilaterally. These were the imaging findings which were there, which shows that there is an area in the chest. CT shows an area of an infective focus, probably suggestive of tuberculosis, and the NCCT brain showing a fresh infarct in the PCA territory and some old infarcts in the thalamus and some old infarcts in the MCA territory at higher up, which probably is not, we cannot see in this particular scan. The CSF was suggestive of chronic meningitis, and this a PCR for Mycobacterium tuberculosis was positive. So a very fairly typical presentation of chronic meningitis, and she has presented with infarct, and these are some of her. I don't think there'll be a single neurologist who would be in practice and I would have not seen a case of tubercular meningitis along with stroke. It is it's a very common situation which we all see. So how common are strokes and vascular involvement in tuberculous meningitis? So so just to speak on it over the next few minutes, I will cover this particular topic. And the involvement of vessels in tubercular meningitis was known as far as back as this particular paper, which I picked up from the PubMed, and it is shows in 1896 the vascular changes of tubercular meningitis, especially the tubercular endarteritis. So it has been known well since that time. So just a minute. Yeah, so next. So tuberculous meningitis is one of the most devastating conditions and presentation of tuberculosis. And it constitutes about 10% of all tuberculosis cases and is responsible for about 40% of deaths in tuberculosis in developing countries. And stroke in tubercular meningitis can occur as frequently as 13 to 57% of patients as per one study published in 2011. Most have ischemic strokes, but the spectrum can include CVT. And again, this has been published. And also subarachnoid hemorrhage due to a tuberculous ruptured, a tuberculous aneurysm which ruptured. Again, this was published in a case report. But we would be focusing on the ischemic stroke, which is much more common and what is we see. So next, how where is the location of the infarct in the brain? There are two methods which have been described to describe the location of the infarct. The first is as per the zones, and the second is as per the vascular supply. There are two zones which have been described. One is the tubercular zone, and the other is the ischemic zone. The tubercular zone is the caudate head. This is what is the tubercular zone on this side of the this is the caudate head, the genu, and the anterior limb of the internal capsule, and the thalamus, the anterior medial thalamus. So this is what is the tubercular zone. And the other zone is the ischemic zone. Again, this predominantly involves the basal ganglia, and it is the putamen and the posterior limb of the internal capsule and the posterior lateral thalamus. So this is the ischemic zone. So most infarcts occur in these two zones as per if we go by the zone distribution. And the other distribution, which is the vascular supply. So as per the vascular supply described by described in this particular journal in 2016, which is much more recent, the as per the zone is described in 1992, but this description is more recent. This is as per the distribution of the vascular as per the vascular territory. Now this is more of a hemodynamic concept rather than an actual anatomical vascular supply of that particular artery. So we have the medial lenticulostriate artery, that is the arteries which supply the lenticulostriate the vessels, which includes the ACA A1 segment and the MCA M1 segment. It supplies the caudate head, the anterior part of the globus pallidus and genu, and the anterior limb of the internal capsule. So somewhat similar to the tubercular zone. The lateral lenticulostriate artery, again, I'm repeating that this is more of a hemodynamic concept, and it includes the M1 and M2 segments. And because it's more of a concept, there is an overlap of the anatomical vessels, which you can see over here. It supplies the head and body of the caudate nucleus, most of the globus pallidus, putamen, posterior limb of the internal capsule, corona radiata, and the external capsule. And then there are the posterior thalamo-perforating arteries, which are basically branches of the P1 and P2 segments of the PCA, which supply the midbrain and the thalamus. So the infarcts are based on these this vascular distribution. So this is this particular study very recently published and showed that they had 40 of the 52 patients had multiple infarcts. And based on zones, the basal ganglia and thalamus was involved in 63% of the patients. They found that 35% of these infarcts in the basal ganglia and thalamus occurred in the ischemic zone. You'd remember the zone which I had mentioned as ischemic zone. And 13% occurred in the tubercular zone, which is more medial. And 15% were mixed. And brainstem, there was about 30% occurred in brainstem and cerebellum, and 15% were cortical. So there was a so this explains the multiple infarcts which were there. And if they classified it as per the vascular territory, then it was more or less equal distribution. That is, 50% of the infarcts were in the area supplied by the perforators of the PCA and the basal artery, and 50% of the infarcts were in the territory supplied by the lateral lenticulostriate arteries, and 23% of the infarcts were in the territory of the medial lenticulostriate arteries. This is some of the infarcts which have been shown here in the territories which have been mentioned over here in this particular paper. In another paper, they found that the locations of the infarct based on the MRI, again, predominantly were in the basal ganglia, that is around 37%. Lobar was in 24%. Subcortical white matter and thalamus were almost 20% each, and brainstem and cerebellum formed about 17% of the infarcts. In this particular study, I decided to show, because there were other studies which have been published much earlier, which have shown similar results to what I have already shown in the more recent studies. This this particular study adopted a different concept in classifying the MR angiographic abnormality, and therefore I thought it is important for us to know this particular concept put forward by the authors. The MR angiography was they found to be abnormal in about 45 out of 101 cases, that is around 45% of the cases. They described two patterns of involvement. Pattern one was a disseminated irregular calibers of intracranial arteries with or without reduction in the distal branches. And pattern two was localized stenosis at the base of the brain. So they found that in logistic regression analysis, the pattern one, that is disseminated irregular calibers, was related to the duration of the disease. That is, the longer the duration, more this pattern was found. Hydrocephalus, presence and age of the patient. Higher the age, it was more likely to have this particular pattern. And pattern two was related to the stage of the disease. That is, the localized stenosis at the base of the brain was related to the presence of basal exudates. Again, it is obvious that it would pinch upon the base of the arteries, and presence of infarction. And in univariate analysis, the pattern one, that is the one which disseminated irregular calibers of the intracranial artery associated with infarct. It correlated with the infarct, and particularly infarct in the tuberculosis zone, and it was associated with poor outcomes in this particular study. This study, again, another study which I have shown earlier by Soni et al., published in Neuroradiology Journal, showed that the most common vascular involvement was the middle cerebral artery in about 3/4 of the patients, followed by the anterior cerebral artery and the ICA. So there was large overlap, that means multiple arteries were involved, and there was PCA involvement in 20% approximately, and basilar artery as per the MR angio in about 11.5%. And they have shown us in this particular panel, which they have provided in the article, they've shown in, involvement of the MCA and the ACA, as well as a part of the ACA, which is seen here. And that had shown, the ICA is not clearly seen, but it has shown involvement in the ICA too. A study by Professor Kalita et al. From SGPGI in 2012 showed similar findings. Their abnormalities showed that 50% of their patients had abnormal MR angiography. The MCA was commonly involved in 21 of these 34 patients. That means, again, correlating approximately with the study which we have just shown earlier, the more recent study, followed by a PCA involvement in 14 out of 34, ICA involvement in 8 out of 34, and ACA involvement in 5 out of 34, and basilar involvement in 5 patients. One patient had vertebral and superior cerebellar involvement. 1/4 of the patients had abnormality in both anterior and posterior circulations, again suggestive of multiple infarcts, similar to what we have shown in the previous study. This modality, that is transcranial Doppler, has also been studied in the evaluation of vasculopathy in tuberculosis meningitis. That means looking at the flow patterns and the hemodynamics. So here in this particular study, 36 patients were recruited, and focally elevated flow velocities in the MCA was observed in around 30%, bilateral in 6 of them, and the Lindegaard ratio was elevated in 90%, and which persisted for some time. Importantly, 80% of the patients with tubercular meningitis and with vasculopathy by TCD criteria also had narrowing in the CT angio and MR angio. So it correlated with the anatomical findings in addition to the hemodynamic findings, which were there. So these were studies which were focused predominantly in children, and they showed similar findings at what we have already described in the previous slides. That is the imaging features of the brain and the vessels and spine in the pediatric population showed changes of vasculopathy, and also transcranial Doppler also has been studied in children also, and it showed similar findings as to what I have just shown in the previous slide. Recently, advanced MRI techniques have been used in tuberculosis meningitis, and they have found that a significant difference was seen in the mean cerebral blood flow in the region of the basal ganglia of the cases and controls. So again, suggested that the vessels and the hemodynamics takes place in the previously described tuberculosis and ischemic zone, as I had mentioned earlier, and this is the other places most prone to infarcts. So what is the mechanism of stroke in tuberculosis meningitis? We have seen that there is vessel involvement. We have seen that the vessel involvement appears to be extensive involvement, and it is in multiple areas. And we have also seen that certain areas are in the brain have a predilection for infarction in tuberculosis meningitis. So what is the mechanism? Mechanisms which have been described is multiple. There is inflammatory basal exudates which lead to constriction, vasospasm, and thrombosis of the vessels causing passing through. There is spread of meningeal inflammation to the vessels causing vasculitis and thrombosis. There is dilated ventricles causing stretching of the inflamed vessels. And there is intimal proliferation and procoagulant state late in the disease. So multiple mechanisms are at play which can cause infarcts here. This is another very recent study which found that a significant correlation between platelet abnormality and stroke in patients with tuberculosis meningitis was reported. Results of this univariate analysis revealed that hematological parameters such as mean platelet volume, platelet distribution width, and platelet large cell ratio and platelet aggregometry were significantly associated with infarct. So some platelet abnormality also appears to exist as per this study. What about patients who have co-infection with HIV? So it has been seen that they are more prone to infarcts if they have co-infection HIV and tuberculosis meningitis, as we saw in our index or representative case, which I had shown in the beginning. This particular study by Vassey et al. Published in Stroke in 2018 from Pakistan showed that vascular risk factors may influence mechanism of stroke in older patients. That means those people who have the traditional vascular risk factors were more prone to strokes and who had tuberculosis meningitis were more prone to strokes. This is a very interesting and I find a very important study published from PGI Chandigarh, and probably it's a landmark study which I could find. This deals with the vascular pathology, which the authors found by doing autopsy in 51 cases of tuberculosis meningitis. So they focus purely on the vascular complications of tuberculosis meningitis. They found that their findings were similar in both the anterior and the posterior circulation on gross anatomy. The basilar artery involvement was found in 59% of the cases. Again, this is gross as of now, as we'll see a little later. And the MCA was involved in 46% of the cases. The smaller branches of all arteries were almost universally affected. That means 100% of the basilar artery and 94% of the MCA were of the small branches of these arteries were involved. The vascular involvement was more prominent in branches of the MCA and the basilar artery embedded with the exudate, and it was expected in this fashion. They found three types of lesions within the vessels. There was the proliferative lesion, which is seen over here, which can be of the concentric type and or the eccentric type. And then the infiltrative lesion. This is the infiltrative lesion. This is using a particular stain showing the entima was intact. This is the infiltrative lesion seen over here. And then there's the necrotizing lesion over here. And this is the fresh thrombus within the vessel wall. So they found predominantly, this has been described earlier also, but they have documented by histopathological examination these three type of lesions. Now let's look at in this particular study, the two major vessels, that is the middle cerebral artery and the basilar artery, the kind of pathological lesions seen in these two vessels. So they found that the most common lesion was the infiltrative lesion in both the vessels. So infiltrative lesions are the ones which I have shown over here, that is this type of lesions. And the necrotizing lesions were more common, as you can see, in the smaller branches. This is the larger branch, larger branches which were spared, and this is the smaller branches which showed maximum. Most of them were involved. So the necrotizing lesions were involved more in the smaller branches, and similarly in the posterior circulation, the basilar artery also. And proliferative lesions were seen in both the vessels, and there were mixed type of lesions also seen here. They also found that macroscopic infarctions were predominantly in the MCA territory, whereas the microscopic infarctions were mostly in the basilar artery. The distribution is shown here. It is similar to previous studies which I have already projected. Basal ganglia and cortex were involved. So interesting, macroscopic were predominantly in the anterior, while microscopic were predominantly in the basilar artery. The pathogenesis of the vascular pathology is not clearly understood, but it may be speculated that the arterial inflammation starts from the periarterial location because of the direct effect of the pro-inflammatory cytokines such as TNF-alpha and interleukins secreted by the lymphocytes and macrophages. The TNF-alpha dominates in the CSF of TBM patients and may induce vascular toxicity due to prothrombocytopenia. Let's see the next particular slide. These few recent studies have shown that there are certain biomarkers which have been identified in stroke and tuberculosis meningitis patients, which are increased in these patients. This has also been demonstrated by Professor Kalita and Professor Mishra earlier in their studies, which they found that there was a possible role of transforming growth factor in tuberculosis meningitis as a cause for the stroke. Vascular, and the same authors also found in a previous study in 2013, a vascular endothelial VEGF in tuberculosis meningitis. So what are the risk factors which makes the person more prone to strokes in these patients? The risk factors in this particular study published in and very recently showed in their study, they found age less than 3 years. They found presence of convulsions, presence of hydrocephalus, increased the chances of a person having a stroke. And this study was published from CNC Vellore. There have been several previous studies which have looked at risk factors for strokes. Some of them have been prospective, some of them have been retrospective. And this retrospective study, which I have already mentioned earlier, was from Pakistan and had shown multiple risk factors. So these risk factors have been summarized in this table, which showed that demographics, that is higher age in most studies, have shown that it is associated with stroke. Then there's advanced stages of meningitis, traditional vascular risk factors, presence of focal neurological deficit, cranial nerves, and vision impairment is associated with presence of stroke if we do the imaging. Investigations like high CSF WBC is associated with stroke and TBM. And imaging features of meningeal enhancement, basal exudates, and hydrocephalus is also associated with strokes. So coming now to treatment, it has been shown that patients can develop stroke despite ATT. So it is not, ATT is ineffective in preventing vascular involvement. So what about acute treatment of stroke? What about thrombolysis? So I think this discussion has taken place in earlier, and I would just say that thrombolysis, although there is no evidence for it and it can be dangerous leading to hemorrhage, and I could not find any evidence to show evidence for endovascular intervention. But there have been other studies done in this particular subject. There was a randomized trial or phase two trial, which was published in 2018. And subsequently, there was a meta-analysis and published in Neurology India, which showed, which they had pooled in four trials of 546 patients. And they found that aspirin reduces the risk of new infarctions in patients with tuberculosis meningitis, but does not affect mortality. So this was the result of a meta-analysis which was published very recently in 2019. There was another study done in 2000 India by Professor Mishra et al, and which they had three groups in which they had given aspirin in one, aspirin and steroids in another, and neither in the third group. And in this group they found that the combination, that is what is shown here, had improved survival chances with an adjusted hazard ratio of 1.55, and this was found to be significant. So the combination fared better than the other two, which was there.
Salil, could you hurry up, please?
So just last one or two slides, that's it,
sir. Yeah, okay, fine.
So they have found that others have used as case reports thalidomide in the treatment, cyclophosphamide in the treatment. And the outcomes of all these patients who have had infarct have been uniformly poor in all the studies, and mortality occurred in tubercular meningitis and in infarcts in these patients. So I would just summarize by giving a few take-home messages from my talk, because shows that stroke occurs commonly in patients with tubercular meningitis. 20% have, 30% studies have shown that can be clinical, 50% can be there on imaging as I've shown, 70% can be macroscopic, and almost 100% of patients with tubercular meningitis may have involvement of the vessel. So it should not be a stroke, it should be involvement of the vessel wall. Common locations may be basal ganglia and the thalamus. Based on the vascular supply, the infarcts may occur in the medial lenticular striae, lateral lenticular striae, and posterior thalamoperforator territories. These are the territories which I mentioned earlier. MR angiography in tubercular meningitis can identify certain patterns of involvement which predict poor outcomes, that is, and who have the propensity to develop infarcts. All major vessels can be involved, MCA being the commonest. The pathogenesis of stroke appears to be linked to inflammation, and there are multiple mechanisms which have been put forward as the cause for the stroke. And microscopically, three types of lesions are described, that is infiltrative, necrotizing, and proliferative. Certain risk factors may make the person more prone to strokes, as I mentioned, aspirin alone or in combination may benefit and the outcome is poor. Thank you.
Yeah, Salil, very good presentation, comprehensive. Is there any questions? Salil, before the questions come, I just have a small comment. Am I audible?
Sir, please go ahead.
Yeah, is there any relationship between IRIS and tuberculosis with infarct? IRIS.
IRIS. So, sir, search which I could find, I did not find any association in any of the evidence which is there. But yes, IRIS is also basically linked to an increased upgradation of the immune response. So you have lots of things described with IRIS, worsening of situations, etc., which can be there. So it sounds logical that infarct also may be one of them. But in my search of all the literature which I did in this preparation for the stroke, I could not find any IRIS as one of the causes described as cause for the stroke.
Salil, some people have been using other immunosuppressants. Some people have been using other immunosuppressants like thalidomide and, you know, things like that. So what is their role and where is the niche? Which type of patients would you use it and when? It's a little unclear to us. So could you clarify?
So like I mentioned, sir, the primary reason for the stroke in these patients is inflammation and uncontrolled inflammation, which is taking place in these patients and involvement of the vessel wall, vasculopathy. So based on that, people have used steroids, and based on the platelet dysfunction, which again I showed in a study, people have used antiplatelet agents. But sometimes there are strokes, which we all would have seen, which you do everything despite hiking up the dose of steroids, etc. You'll find still new strokes appearing. So I guess based on such logic, people have used, and there are some case reports which have been published, and I showed two of them where they have used thalidomide and somebody has used cyclophosphamide also. But the in the patient with cyclophosphamide, the outcome was better. But overall, it's just case report based evidence. So I will not go too much on that as yet.
So Dr. Nasli, there is a question in the Q&A, if you can kindly take that.
Yeah.
Dr. Harita has asked Dr. Gupta, what is the option in a patient with tuberculous meningitis who develops recurrent strokes whenever oral steroids are tapered while on regular ATT? Is there a role for pulse methylprednisolone or other immunosuppressants?
So again, I'll answer it in two ways. Is there evidence for it? And second thing is, what is the experience, individual experiences? As far as evidence goes for it, I showed these studies which have already been published as far as the literature goes. And this study has been from India, that is the combination of steroids and the use of antiplatelets both together have reduced the occurrence of new strokes, not the improvement in mortality. So the other situation is the use of pulse methylprednisolone. It is similar to using other immunosuppressives related to the question which Dr. Echapuri had asked. If we find we are up against the wall and we have no other options, well, methylprednisolone can be used, because in any case, whatever is happening, the patient is going down. So one can use pulse steroids. Like the primary problem appears to be an uncontrolled inflammation which is taking place there.
Yeah, in fact, PGIs, they used to came out with a paper on thalidomide. What is your take on the subject?
So I just, Dr. Echapuri had also asked that same question. I asked just now, I just mentioned that the thalidomide, again, from what I could find is based on case report studies. I could not find this paper which you have mentioned, sir, on PGI, from PGI. I did not find that, but I found case report based thalidomide use in patients who have had uncontrolled strokes despite all measures which have taken place. And this is fairly recent, which is about 3 years ago or 4 years ago.
Any other questions from the host? We have still about 3 minutes for this speaker's timing.